Subdural hemorrhage can be broken down. Sub means below. Dural refers to the outermost protective layer of the brain, which is the dura mater. And hemorrhage refers to bleeding. So a subdural hemorrhage is when there's bleeding below the dura mater. All right, let's start with some basic brain anatomy. The brain is protected by the meninges, which are three thin layers of tissue which cover the brain and spinal cord. The inner layer of the meninges is the pia mater, the middle layer is the arachnoid mater, and the outer layer is the dura mater. The pia and arachnoid maters are also called leptomeninges. Between the leptomeninges, there's the subarachnoid space, which houses cerebral spinal fluid, or CSF. CSF is a clear, watery liquid which is pumped around the spinal cord and brain, cushioning them from impact and bathing them in nutrients. The outer membrane, the dura mater, consists of two layers. The internal layer of the dura mater lies above the arachnoid mater, and the two are separated by the subdural space. The external layer of the dura mater adheres to the inner surface of the skull. These two layers of the dura mater travel together, but at certain spots the internal layer of the dura mater separates from the external one to form the meningeal folds. The meningeal folds help divide the sections of the brain, like the falx cerebri, which separates the two hemispheres of the cerebrum, and the tentorium, which covers the cerebellum and separates it from the cerebrum. Between the external layer of the dura mater and the inner surface of the skull, there are arteries that supply the meninges. The subdural space plays a major role in venous blood drainage in the brain. The surface of the brain is supplied by numerous arteries in the subarachnoid space that provides oxygen-rich blood to the brain. After the brain tissue has taken up the oxygen and nutrients, the blood drains into superficial cerebral veins, or bridging veins, that also sit in the subarachnoid space. These veins travel through the arachnoid mater, pass through the subdural space, and penetrate the inner layer of the dura mater to drain into the dural venous sinuses located between the two layers of the dura mater. Eventually, the blood in the venous sinuses drains into the internal jugular vein and returns to the heart. So, the main cause of a subdural hemorrhage is a rupture of the bridging veins located in the subdural space. When a blood vessel is damaged and there's active bleeding, it's called a hemorrhage, and the collection of blood that results is called a hematoma. Some people, like the elderly, often have brain atrophy, where their brain shrinks in size. And that means that the bridging veins are stretched across a wider space where they're largely unsupported, kind of like a rickety bridge across a mountain pass. In infants and in individuals that abuse alcohol, the veins are thin-walled, and therefore more likely to break. Subdural hematomas are common in head traumas, like falling in a wet bathtub and whacking your head, or in shaken baby syndrome, where a baby is violently shaken, making their head whip back and forth, which damages the bridging veins. Subdural hematomas can also happen after an acceleration-deceleration injury, like speeding on the road and then suddenly slamming on the brakes. When that happens, the seatbelt will stop the body and head from moving forward, but the momentum will carry the brain forward where it impacts the front of the skull. Right after that, the head moves backwards and hits the headrest, causing the brain to impact the back of the skull. That rapid back-and-forth movement once again causes damage to the bridging veins. Regardless of the mechanism, once a bridging vein is torn, the blood pools in the subdural space and creates a hematoma. Since the damaged bridging veins are under low pressure, the bleeding can be slow, which causes delayed onset of symptoms which might develop over the course of days to weeks, as the hematoma gradually expands. So an acute subdural hematoma causes symptoms within 2 days. A subacute subdural hematoma causes symptoms between 3 and 14 days. And a chronic subdural hematoma causes symptoms after 15 days. The hematoma can compress the brain and cause increased intracranial pressure. A large subdural hematoma on one side of the skull can cause a midline shift, which is a displacement of the whole brain toward the opposite side of the skull. The increased intracranial pressure can also cause the brain to herniate. There can be a supratentorial herniation, where the cerebrum is pushed against the skull or the tentorium, as well as an infratentorial herniation, where the cerebellum is pushed against the brainstem. Both of these can be lethal. Supratentorial herniations can compress the arteries that nourish the brain, which can lead to an ischemic stroke. And infratentorial herniations can compress the vital area in the brainstem that controls consciousness, respiration, and heart rate. The most common symptoms of a subdural hemorrhage are loss of consciousness right after the injury, or in the ensuing days to weeks as the hematoma increases in size. Other symptoms include headaches and vomiting. Sometimes there can be focal neurological symptoms like muscle weakness or sensory problems based on the location of the hematoma. Diagnosis of a subdural hemorrhage is typically done with an imaging study. On a CT scan, an acute subdural hematoma shows up as a hyperdense mass, meaning that it looks more white than the surrounding healthy brain tissue. A chronic subdural hematoma, on the other hand, shows up as a hypodense mass, which is less white than the surrounding brain tissue. An acute on chronic bleeding is a combination of hyperdense and hypodense, which is seen in individuals who have a re-bleed in the bridging veins after a chronic hematoma has already formed. The blood in a subdural hemorrhage is located between the arachnoid mater and the inner layer of the dura mater. So on a CT scan, subdural hematomas follow the contour of the brain and form a crescent shape and cross suture lines. In contrast to that, epidural hemorrhages cause blood to build up between the outer layer of the dura mater and the skull. Since the outer layer of the dura mater adheres tightly to the skull at sutures, epidural hematomas don't cross suture lines and they push on the brain, forming a biconvex shape. Small subdural hematomas are drained by placing a small tube called a catheter through a drilled hole in the skull. Large subdural hematomas require a craniotomy, which is when part of the skull bone is removed, in order to remove the accumulated blood below. Alright, as a quick recap. A subdural hemorrhage is a bleeding below the dura mater, caused by the rupture of the bridging veins found within the subdural space. Subdural hemorrhages are common in traumatic accidents, as well as in some groups like the elderly, babies, and individuals that abuse alcohol. On a CT scan, an acute subdural hemorrhage forms a hyperdense blood collection, whereas a chronic subdural hemorrhage forms a hypodense blood collection. Subdural hematomas cross suture lines and follow the contour of the brain, forming a crescent shape, unlike epidural hematomas, which don't cross suture lines and push on the brain and form a biconvex shape.